So we got introduced to finite element method. We started with our model problem, then the weak or the variational form of the problem. Then once we have this weak or variational form of the problem, on this problem we applied our finite element method. Then this weak form got reduced to algebraic form. We have seen all the details of this. Then the algebraic variable is a is an element. Typically we calculated all the elements, and firstly we observed it is symmetric, then we also observed it is sparse. Then we have to just verify this A is also positive definite now. So we have to verify the positive definite, this is where we left, and then if it is positive definite then we will be able to invert it out, and this is where we stop. So now let us look at the positive definiteness aspect of it, then I think all the things that we require to cover we would have covered. Okay. So the matrix M cross M is positive definite. Let us verify that, simply take the quadratic form of this and see, show that it is positive. That is all is the thing that we have to do. So this is true. So for a vector in Rn, so consider the quadratic form. So pick up a vector, any arbitrary vector in Rn, and let us look at this quadratic form. So this, if you were to expand, it will be, you will be able to write this as I equals to 1 to, so this should be Rm. Just giving the expanded version of this, like this is a vector of a vector, this is a matrix of size m cross m, this is a vector of size m cross 1. So the, this is a quadratic form, usual quadratic form that we consider. So just expand it out. If you expand it out, this comes out to be, so now we substitute for this. So this is this quadratic which we already know. So so that is a quadratic form, quadratic. Now we have to ensure that this quadratic form is positive. So this can be rewritten as, take this sigma inside. So this can be rewritten as sigma over I equals to 1 to m of eta I phi dash sigma j equals to 1 to m eta j phi j dash. Just it can be directly written like this without any loss. So what is this quantity? This quantity is nothing but v dash, and this quantity is v dash. So typically it is denoting what? This is nothing but v dash comma v dash. Because without dash it is v, that is the expression of the v. V is any element of, or vh dash, you can just say vh dash, or any element there can be written like that. For v belongs to vh, it is some element, because it is written in terms of the basis functions, derivatives of the basis functions, right. If it is written in terms of the derivatives of the basis functions, so v dash you will just get. Now this is what? This is definitely a positive quantity, because integral of v dash square. So what?
Take n k n
constant. A eta. Ah, okay. So eta. So this would naturally come out to be, this is a positive definite, is a positive. So we know that this is going to be for, since I equals to 1 to m eta I, because these are the basis functions, so any element can be written in terms of, so it's a positive definition, it's very clear, therefore this is also verified. So now therefore A is symmetric and positive definite, so this implies that A inverse exists. So if A inverse exists, then you get your xi vector. If you get the xi vector, then you are done. So now this was one thing which we need to verify. So whatever formulation we can, in fact is also this way of proving a solution for a problem in the finite dimensions exists, this is also become a proof for the existence in the finite solution of the problem in finite dimensions. It can also be viewed as a proof for that. So what next? We started with a model problem, we converted to the weak or the variational form of the problem, then we applied the finite element method in one dimensions, then we reduced the differential equations to an algebraic problem, and we ensured that we checked up that the matrix that we get, the linear system that we get is invertible, therefore the solution exists. Next, what is that we have to see, how good is the solution? So we have to see what are the kind of the errors which are involved, how good is the solution, we have to get an assessment, right. So I have now a subspace VH of dimension m, so dimension of this subspace was m because this was spanned by m basis vectors, right. And these m basis vectors are defined based on the m subdivisions, the m plus 1 nodes that you had, you had introduced all these basis functions and all these m nodes by subdividing the element. Now what is that basically we have seen, we have basically seen instead of solving a continuous problem, we are solving the problem in a discrete fashion, so by looking at m divisions. So if you move more and more close to the continuous nature, that means if we include more and more subdivisions, you are moving more and more, you consider more and more points, more and more discrete points, that means you are moving more and more towards considering the full interval. Of course we will never consider full interval, but more, as the more number of points are considered, then what we would expect, we would expect the solution to get very closer to the continuous solution, the error should, because otherwise it, there should be convergence. So we need to ensure that this property is satisfied here. In other words, the whatever we are doing is a convergent process, the error can be assessed based on the number of subdivisions you have. Lesser the number of subdivisions, probably we expect the error to be relatively more, and if there are more subdivisions, we expect it to be much better in general, right. So now how do we assess it mathematically for the given model problem? Let us look at it. This whatever I discuss again here is a generic process which you will be able to apply for any problem. So for simplicity in this particular case, whatever we will be doing will come out very easily using a basic calculus, but much more problems, rigorous problems are in higher dimensions, we need to have tools from Sobolev spaces, which you will see Professor Kotina will be using a lot in his lectures. Now to get a feel of what exactly this means, how we can assess the error for this model problem, we have to introduce some basic results and tools, and we will go ahead assessing the error that we have committed and see whether this error decreases or not, we will be able to assess it. So let us look at it. So now we are going to look at error estimate . Of course, when you say a model problem here, we are talking about our finite element analysis. Error estimate for basically we mean for our FEM. Applied on the weak formulation. That is what basically we are looking. So, what is the error that we have committed in our finite element computation? This is what we would like. So, for that, we before we get into this, we have to introduce few things. So, first thing is, so let UH let u h be the solution of finite element problem v h. That is what we are saying is a u h satisfies u h prime v prime equals to f v for all v belonging to v h. Right, we will call this as so we let u be the solution of problem D, that is the original solution of the continuous problem, strong problem. Now, what is that we are interested in looking at? Continuous problem. So, we will say let u be the solution of FEM applied to D. So, directly we are applying that, that means we are not coming to the finite dimensions, but we will be directly looking at the problem V itself. I think I should write it as V, maybe the better way of writing it as this solution of problem V. So, that means you are in the infinite dimensions, right, in the infinite dimension, then the problem V, variational problem in infinite dimensions, means then u prime V prime is equals to for all V. Now, this V belongs to the space V, this is belongs to V h, that belongs to. So, let us call this as so also note that V h is a subspace of V. So, without any loss we will be able to consider. So, what is that we are interested in looking at? Why are we interested in looking at V? So, when we are actually replacing this problem with a finite dimensional problem, that means from V to V h. So, V h has got dimension m, depending upon number of the subdivisions we have, more the number of subdivision more we will get it. So, now when we are obviously from a continuous problem we have moved to a discrete problem, so there is going to be some error, the difference between u and u h. So, u h is not going to be as good as u, we would like to assess what is this. So, in this case if you were to consider these two things, then consider this. So, what does this say? This would straight away say this is equal to u prime minus u h prime v is equal to 0 for all v belonging to v h. So, I have to pick up here this v is in capital V, but capital V is superspace of this. So, this I can work with this V itself, V from V h is also good enough, all V from V h can also be applied here because there is subspace of that. So, this is going to be for all V in V h, this is always 0, right. What it is saying, this is called as Galerkin orthogonality. So, we will physically look at what is its meaning. So, it is called as so, what is it basically saying? I think so far everything is clear, right. So, now what is it basically saying? So, geometrically if you were to look at it, suppose the suppose the space V H and U is any vector so it says that so this is what this is an orthogonal projection this is a U minus U H so U is so this vector is U minus U H right because it is orthogonal projection because it is 0 so this pick up any vector in this space so I know if I pick up a vector v from this space this is vh we said so for v belonging to vh multiplied by an orthogonal vector is always 0 so I pick up a vector little v from this and take anything which is orthogonal to that that is 0 so since it is 0 this is an this is called as an orthogonal result and this is this indicates orthogonality so what it says in other words which v this v you are talking or this v you are talking here so this what is this problem is vh so in vh what is my space vh is a space the problem vh I got the finite dimensional space this is a finite dimensional space
element of vh is small vh
huh
element of vh
Hi, it's okay, but here you understand. I have put this whole thing is indicating. I have not written it as a VH here because I want to replace this V again. I am going to replace this VH. Now, as long as we clearly write, it doesn't matter. You have that understanding, right? So, I want to maintain this as a V itself, but I have indicated it is an element of this here. Just to make sure, when I write this V here again, if I write VH, I write a VH here. So there is a V there. Again. There may be a confusion here or here, but it doesn't matter. As long as you indicate it correctly, it doesn't matter, right?
U minus U dash minus U dash.
Which one?
Right side.
So
this. Here, yeah.
The expression.
Yeah, V dash. So now I consider this and then I consider the vector which is going to be there and then that is going to be orthogonal to this space clearly it is saying that right. So that is a very important result which says that you can also interpret what do you what you can interpret here you can also interpret that. So if I am trying to pick up a representative element for this from this space the best possible element that you can take is going to be UH in fact we are going to show that. Go to the best approximation. That's what we will be showing. It in fact it says that this is basically saying that this is an orthogonal projection onto this space. Whatever U H is nothing but an orthogonal projection of U from the space V onto the space V H. That's what this is basically indicating. So that is why it is called as Galerkin orthogonality. So this is this result is something which we will be repeatedly using several times. I'm just giving an interpretation. I just took this as a space V H, right? So this is a vector u. So now, if I were to draw anything perpendicular to this, this is u minus u h. In this case, it is u minus u h, right? U minus. Now here, this is saying basically, if I were to take this, this is going to be zero for a v belonging to v h. This is true. That means this is orthogonal. If we were to look at this, this basically indicates this is going to be zero only when it is going to be orthogonal. Hi, it's a given. It doesn't matter.
Approximation only in
there. No, we are not come to best of it. It's only Galerkin orthogonality. It's only said this is an orthogonal, but the projection that we say is an orthogonal projection. That's all it says. It's not a best approximation. We will in fact be showing best approximation. That's a CS lemma. We will come to that. Right now, it only says that whatever the UH I am going to consider, it is the projection, orthogonal projection onto the space. So, in fact, such an orthogonal projection happens to be the best approximation that we will show it. It only shows it's an orthogonal projection. So now we will move into the immediately what is the best. This UH is in fact is going to be the best approximation. We will try to look at that result. So now the best approximation result is the following. So this best approximation result is also known as Sias lemma. So what does this lemma say? This lemma says that let U and UH be the solutions of in fact, we could also have written, I mean this confusion would not have arose if I had just written as this. So that V prime this problem will not come if I write it like this, the more general framework would have been this. So usually they present in this way, we have written for a model problem. So U is a solution of this and UH is a solution of the finite dimensional version of the problem. If you want, you can write even V there as long as you indicate it correctly there. If these are the Sias lemma, if U and UH are the solutions of the infinite dimensional variational problem, the finite dimensional variational problem. So let all the conditions so we discussed yesterday the Lax-Milgram. Let us suppose that all the conditions of Lax-Milgram lemma be satisfied. Lax-Milgram so I will not repeat this. We know that A is the bilinear form, is continuous, bounded, squared, so on, and we have a bounded linear form. So all these properties are true for these two forms, for A and L. Then the Sias lemma says that there exists a constant C independent of the discretization such that U minus UH is always less than or equal to the norm of U minus UH in the space V, the norm as induced by the inner product in the space V, it is less than or equal to infimum of so this is the best approximation result. What does this say? If I have the solutions of the infinite dimensional variational problem and the finite dimensional variational problem, then if this bilinear form in the variational problem and the linear form, they respect all the conditions as defined in the Lax-Milgram lemma. That means they are bilinear form is continuous, coercive, linear form is bounded and L is bounded linear, L belongs to V prime. If those conditions are satisfied, then definitely there exists a constant C independent of the discretization. That means C is not a function of C, does not depend on H, C is independent of H, that is what it says. Then I will be able to get a result like this. What it says, the error V U minus UH is the amount of the error that you commit from moving from a continuous variational problem to a discrete variational problem. That means we, so that is always bound by u minus v for any element in V. So what it says is the best representative element in the space, in the finite dimensional space for u is u h. That is what it is. If you go away from it, any other element if you were to go, it is the error that you would commit would be more. That is what it says. You prove this, right? This should be V H.
Infimum over V
H. Infimum over the measured in this. Yeah, this should be V H. Okay, that should be. For any other element, if you were to pick up from this, then that would be. That's true. So if you move away from this, I think this because this norm exists. Once this whether the U is an U H is an element of V or V H, this norm is anyhow defined because then the element of that. So that's what basically this is saying. Okay.
Greater than one also, then why do we call it best approximation?
Huh?
C is the constant C would be greater than one also.
Yeah, no problem. See, let if C is greater than one, we don't know what is C. Some constant, a positive constant. So if C is greater than one,
why do we call it best?
The best in the sense that from the, what is the from the space V H, so U H is an element of it, and V is all these are all the V's from the space V H. The element that you are representative element that you are picking up is the best. If you pick up any other, so what you are saying, if C is greater than 1, so that may not be the
best approximation, but it is order wise it is the same
order. What you are saying here is, suppose I have this constant, we right now we don't know, we assume that this constant is also a constant which is not going to violate that. So obviously this constant, if it is going to violate, what I am saying is, suppose this constant is 100, so does it make any sense for I may be able to get it. So this constant should also be respecting that condition. That is right now, so we need to know what is the estimate, and these constants we right now we assume that they are respecting that condition. If it is not, then it has no meaning naturally. When so if you want to get an estimate of these constants, we can also estimate them. So there is a different way of doing how, what exactly is the magnitude of this constant, becomes very important to look at it. So right now we will take it, this constant respects the conditions to hold definitely, otherwise it will not make sense. We can also go about estimating this constant. This constant will be very important, that will actually that will go lead into what is known as a posterior estimates later, but we will not right now worry about it, right. This only says the element that I picked up, this constant is we could also explicitly say the constant is such that it is not only positive, it also allows this to be the best. So we are to really certify that, maybe one has to go and see what exactly this constant is. So one can estimate these constants also, but I think right now we will not worry. So anything else there? So what, once again, so we have a solution, we have an infinite dimensional variational problem. We are replacing it with a finite dimensional variational problem. So when you replace it, you are committing some error. So the error that you would commit by picking up u h is supposed to be better than picking up some other element from the same space. That is what it says. So let us try to prove this result now. So we will prove this result and then see. What?
This constant C is
theorem does not say. See what exactly theorem is saying. Theorem. There exists a constant. That's all it says. We will see as we go along.
If we change h, then
it is independent of h.
No, it is independent of h.
Yes. For all h, it is going to be true. See, for some, if that I can always replace it, if it is true for point 1, it is also true for anything else bigger than that. So So we will keep all these questions as we go along the proof, see what is it figuring out from that. Okay, it only says, and then we also have just now seen that this element is nothing but an orthogonal projection of this. This is what we have just seen. So this is obviously intuitively it says that if I am going to take what is really close to this, but I would like to pick up something from this space which is very close to that. So close to that in terms of the orthogonal projection is supposed to be close intuitively. It is also clear to us, right? So even if you move away from the orthogonal projection, intuitively it is it may not be the right element. So
projection is not in the norm of the Hilbert space V.
What?
This orthogonal projection is not in the norm of the.
No, that's in the given space. That is the norm that we are considering.
Energy norm.
The energy. So the different norms. If you have to look at it in this norm, it's only talking in terms of this norm.
So in this norm, it may not be the best approximation.
So in this norm, it is in this norm what we have written is, see, this is also A U H B prime was coming. That's what he was asking. Harim was also saying why it is B prime. That was actually the energy norm. In the energy norm, it is true. The B prime actually says the energy norm, and this B norm is exactly the energy norm.
No, it is.
So the orthogonal projection is also in the B norm only.
This norm of B, this may not be the energy norm. We are considering both.
Right now, for us, this norm is that. It is that norm. So if you go for some other norm. We have to see what happens to that result. So what is the kind of result? So it's only a best. It's only says orthogonal projection that we are having now is satisfying this criteria. That's all it says. Okay. Let's now prove this result. So V H is subspace of V. So for any element for V belonging to VH, this is always true. Both in the finite dimension, infinite dimensional, both the things it is, this is true for any element V belonging to that. So this is by linearity of here. This is, I am just repeating the Galerkin orthogonality. We straight away get the Galerkin orthogonality for that U minus U H V is equal to 0. This is true for all V belonging to V H. That usually when we write it is in the this we have already seen, this is a Galerkin orthogonality. This is always true. So we use the using the coercivity because we are saying that all the properties of the Lax-Milgram lemma are satisfied. So let us use the coercivity property using the coercivity property of the bilinear form. So we get we know this is the Galerkin orthogonality is equal. Let's put it here. Galerkin orthogonality. So that's basically a coercivity property. We have picked up an element. This element also belongs to the same space, so we can write the coercivity with respect to that. But this is nothing but. So do some simple manipulation there and you will be able to get U minus U H U minus V plus A of So obviously this is going to be 0 because we picked up an element v from vh. So this is by the Galerkin orthogonality, this is going to be true. So what we are left with only so since A is satisfying all the conditions on Lax-Malgrand, the A bilinear form is also bounded, therefore there exists a positive constant m such that this is true. So this implies directly that u minus u h is less than or equal to m by alpha times so hence the result. So C times infimum of V belonging to VH. So now you just look at the source of this C is basically defined in terms of these two. So if you want to really get an estimate, we can go back and see the continuity. What should be the? I think we will be able to estimate. We will be able to do that and get an idea about the whole thing. So m is definitely independent, the way m is there, m is independent of h clearly, so the constant is independent of h, so this is what it is saying. So now the element that we picked up, the element which the orthogonal projection of u onto the space vh, that is uh, that seems to be the element which is better than all other elements that you are going to consider there. So now let's move on to the next result. But you, when you actually get the UH, how are you representing UH in your finite dimensional space? In the finite dimensional space, again, we said it's an orthogonal projection of this element in the finite dimensional space. But actually, when you calculate UH, we are taking the basis, we are expressing that as a linear combination of all the basis elements of H. That means basically it is not the exact UH, it is the interpolant of the UH that we are getting it. We move to the finite dimensional space, and in the finite dimensional space VH, UH is represented as a linear combination of all the basis functions, right. So, what is that we are basically doing? We are not actually finding UH. We are finding an interpolant of UH. We had a U which is an element of V. So, in the finite dimensional, we are trying to replace this with UH, which is an element of VH, which is a subspace of V. There is some amount of error which comes in there. When we actually come to this, we are actually denoting this by an interpolant of that, which we call the UH tilde, which is nothing but a combination of all these things, some I. Eta I phi I. Right, it is an interpolant of this. So, u h is actually replaced, approximated by an interpolant of this. So there are now, we also have to, so this is how it is getting. So we actually, when you are going to trying to find the error, there is some amount of error which we are also making in terms of the interpolant that also have, will be looked at, need to be looked at. So u h, when we have, we know that the dimension increases, then it becomes a better representative of this. U h as such is now being interpolated. So we will call this u h tilde as an interpolant of u. So u h tilde So essentially, what is that we are saying? Suppose this is your x and this is your u of x. Your solution may something. Let's suppose that your solution is looking something like this. So x is 0 and x is 1. So let's say at a finitely many points, we take a sum. So the solution that we are having. So it is, we have values at all these points, and these we are being interpolated by this using this basis functions. Therefore, u tilde h is called as a interpolant of u. So if you are doing the interpolation, then we will get some error because of the interpolation. Now, what is the error that we are making because of the interpolation? So we will also see interpolation error. It is basically interpolation of all the basis functions. See, when you write the solution u h, basically if you want a solution anywhere else, so when I join this, we are getting a solution in the entire domain, not only on the nodal points. So in between, what basically we are doing is nothing but the interpolation.
Except nodal points, if you are wanting to calculate at some other points, then you are using some interpolation.
When I say solution, I need the solution in the entire domain. So there, that is why I wrote this, this entire domain. I am now joining these points. Joining these points, essentially we can look it as interpolation. So it is nothing but we can look that as an interpolant, basically it is an interpolant. Yes. So the interpolation errors, there are some results on the interpolation errors. U prime of x minus u tilde h, so this is less than or equal to h times, we have to prove this, where h is your In fact, what we are looking at is all in the sup norms. So max norms is all there, because we are writing all the maximum, all the this error that is being estimated is in terms of the sup norm or the max norm. So we have to now, if we were to replace that with u tilde, what is the, so what is the error that you are making in u prime, what is the error that you are making in calculating u, this is how it is going to be. So let us try to estimate this now, let us try, these are the results and we will try to prove this result now. So let us write first, let x belongs to the subdivision j plus 1. So I have, we have introduced these notations I j plus, I was our whole interval, and I j plus 1 is an interval x j, x j plus 1, that is subdivision x j, x j plus 1. So also recall your function phi j is x j plus 1 minus x . So in fact, if you want to just a quick, these expressions we looked at yesterday, so this is, what is this? This is phi j, this is phi j plus 1, right. On this interval only, when we extend it further, we will get the hat functions. Here on this interval, typically on the sub interval of interest, this is phi j, and this is what the expression. We have seen these things already, right. Let us say this is unit value, we will just take it as a unit value. X j and j plus 1, which one? The x j minus 1 should come here, and x j minus 1 will be there. So this is taking the value 1 at x j, therefore this phi j, this is taking the value 1 at j plus 1, so phi j plus 1, which should be j minus 1, which should be j minus 1, is ok, right, because this should take a value 1 at x j plus 1, it is taking value 1. So I said, ok, this is, right, all this is 1. So I have just not truncated it, I just, because I just recall these functions, we can quickly look at it as it were written. So we can write this function phi j as now phi j can be, phi j is nothing but x j plus 1 minus x phi h j plus h j, and in fact both of that you can write as j plus 1, doesn't matter, both of them you can also replace, because both of them are the same things. So let us step 1, we want to prove this, then we will call this what we are doing, let us write step 5, this is step 1, and the step 2. So what are we trying to do? We are trying to estimate, trying to show these two things. So I just have to show these things, I have to make the substitution for all those things. So I am just recalling few things which we have done there. This is the first thing. Then we know for any u is a continuous function there, Taylor series is applicable there. For u of x m by Taylor series expansion, you can write it as u of x plus half of u double prime was I m belongs to the interval. So the x is any point in the neighborhood of that. So we know straight away that we can write this by the Taylor series expansion. So what we do is we multiply these two. With phi m and add in m is add m equal to j and j plus 1 both the cases. So what would we get? We get sigma m equals to j to j plus 1, that is what is m equal to j, j plus 1 we are adding. So what we are doing, we are going to multiply u of x m phi m and add up both the things, that is what it means. So you have to do the same thing on the right hand side. So you will get that u x sigma m equals to j to j plus 1 phi m, you are multiplying right hand side, left hand side both with phi m and taking summation over m j t. So you do the same thing on both the sides, then that is equal to u prime of x sigma so plus sigma m equals to j to j plus 1, right. It is nothing, straight away multiplying with phi m and adding it up. Now let us using the results, we want to simplify this expression. So we use the results, recall that using sigma over m phi m, what is this? This is x and sigma over m phi m is 1 and u tilde of x is nothing but sigma over m because of the interpolation points, whether you take as u tilde of m or u of x m both are same. So you can replace it. This we already seen, this property is true, we have already seen yesterday, this is also true, and this only thing is this is also true, only we are replacing tilde by this, we are replacing tilde by this because we are this is a specific value. So whether u tilde or u, really it's immaterial. So you can replace it there. Now use these things. So using these things, we get u of x minus u of xm will now just boil down to see this is simplified. This using these things in this, this expression 3 will can be, it takes this form. So that is equals to minus sigma half of u double prime I am so therefore that is direct simplification will it, you can just check it up, it comes out automatically here, there is no problem. Therefore u tilde of x minus u tilde of xm is now take the tilde, take the derivative on both sides, that is equal to minus sigma m equals to j plus 1 half of, so this would be multiplied by, I will write it down here, so this is multiplied by phi m prime of x x minus x m minus x whole square minus 2 phi m x m minus x. Right, we have this. Now let us also use the result, since so that is true, so we will be able to replace this quantity by the maximum of that, right, because this is an element psi m is an element belonging to the im plus 1. So we have to actually estimate what we are trying to do, we are trying to now already got this, we estimate this quantity, we also rewrite these quantities, then we will be able to get modulus of this is going to be in the supnorm, we will be able to prove our result. So that is why first we have looked at, we have taken care of this part, what it can be replaced, we will also try to attend to this part. To attend to this part, we require some extra terms. So, what are those extra things that we require? Recall that, also note that so that is x, and I think I am just repeating this again here, this is equal to 1. So, if you were to use these three things put together here into this expression. So we will so also substituting we know the expression for phi m, so find out phi m prime because we also require here phi m prime here. So substitute from the expression for phi m, you will be able to find phi n prime. So substituting the expression for phi m prime, so there is a summation here, you have to take care of the summation, therefore you have to sum over this. So this part of the simplification, if you want I can do it, but I think you will be able to do it. I written out the details, only thing, and not simplifying it, so you will be able to get u prime of x minus u tilde prime of x, this is equals to maximum of half of modulus of x j plus 1 plus x j minus 2 x. So, it requires you have to simplify it a bit, and then you will be able to see that. So, but this quantity is nothing but x j plus 1 minus, sorry, plus x j by 2 minus x. This quantity is going to be always less than or equal to x j by 2. So, getting out this quantity, the simplification I have just directly written it out. When you simplify that part, you will be able to get a direct simplification, take it out and then carry out the simple algebraic manipulations here. You know the expressions of phi m, you know the expressions of phi m tilde. So, substitute all those things, simplify it and sum over sigma. So, these are direct things. So, if you were to do that and simplify it, you will be able to coming up with this an expression of this kind. So, take this half inside and this is always less than or equal to h j by 2. So, this is true for this both the points, the end points of the interval I j plus 1. So, if you take any point inside this and deduct it from that, it is going to be always less than or equal to h j by 2. This is true. So if you were to say this, therefore, our result now, what is that we have done? We got this expression, we estimated this, we estimated this quantity, put both the estimates in this, then we will be able to get the estimate on that. So, therefore, we get u prime of x minus u tilde prime of x is less than or equal to h j by 2 So, this is less than or equal to h times maximum of over 0 less than or equal to y. Right. If it is less than, we know that h j is a typical maximum of all the h j's, right. Therefore, if you were to replace that by h by 2, h by 2 by h, it is not going to matter. So, this is the first estimate, the interpolation estimate that we get. So, what is the time? I think accordingly, if I want to prove the next proof also, I think we will do it. I will skip it and go. So, I think the next proof of it goes more or less analogous to this. We have done in a detailed way this. The next proof is, I will write it out. If there is, so now we have proved the first claim, this is the A. The A part is done. So, now the B part, I will not prove it for the want of time, otherwise, I think we will not go further. So, we would like to prove now the B part. What is the B part? B part says that u of x, this is on the function itself. So, now this is the max norm. So, we will also be able to prove u tilde of h, this is less than or equal to h square by 8. Maybe we should go over this proof in that higher dimensions we will not go through. So, I think I will write this proof. So, this is the error in u in the max norm. So, we have got the error in the derivative in the max norm, the error in the function and due to the interpolation in the max norm is just this. I think Okay, let's prove this also. After that, maybe we will. So let's recall for this, for proving this. So recall that from the previous part of the proof. So whatever we have written, some of the steps of the proof, we are not going to repeat. I'm just going to extract it and put it straight away for you. So if you refer back, you will just have all these things written out for you. So recall that u of x minus this expression we have got it. This is nothing but sigma m equals to j to j plus 1 half of the previous part when we wrote the Taylor series and expand deducted all the things applied various things, we got this part, we are recalling that. So on simplification we got this, on simplification we get u of x minus u tilde of x . So we further simplify this since using this fact, so we will be able to write u of x minus u tilde of x less than or equal to . So you are going to simplify this if you were to use that fact and put it, take it inside this, you will be able to see this part is going to become x, therefore it will become x square there, and this half which has gone there is got cancelled out. So this part with a sigma is x, this half will knock it off, it will become an x square there because of this fact. We know this, so take this summation inside, this will become x, x square, half is knocked out and it becomes that. So again we want to estimate this part, so first we will try to estimate this part, and we already have an estimate on this, so we will just use these two things. So we have to estimate this part so that then the required result we will get it. So we take this part and try to estimate it. So e of x is . So clearly we see that right, if you give call this expression of e of x and take a double derivative on it, then this is going to be minus 2, so which is less than 0. I leave this for your verification. So therefore, so this is already a negative quantity there, first derivative. So e prime of x, if you consider equal to 0, if you evaluate, you get max min. At this point, it will be taking this value. We'll just say, so this is going to be negative. That's going to be the maximum point. Right? So maximum we'll be able to calculate. Therefore, e of, if you were to calculate this quantity comes out to be, use this x bar and calculate what is e. At that point is, so why we are doing this, we want to estimate this quantity so that we will be able to say this is going to be less than or equal to that. So we just get fx is going to be maximum at this point. So at the maximum value of this is this, so you substitute the maximum value of that. So therefore, so we call this as a star there, from star what do we get, we get u of x minus u tilde of x is less than or equal to, so hj is less than h, so I can replace this with h, so all those things same living h square, there is a half there already, and then I think just get a 8 maximum 0 less than or equal to y less than or equal to 1. Right, this half is already there, so you got a 1 by 4 here. So these are results. So in the max norm, the error that you commit in the interpolation is always bound by this quantity. Straight away we see this is. So this is the other result which we wanted to do. We got it. So both the interpolation, the interpolation errors, both in the function and its derivative, we have estimates for it now. Now what is that we would like to look at? We would actually like to look at the FE errors. So what is FE error? Basically, I am actually estimating u by uh, right. So what is the error actually I am committing in replacing u by uh, I would like to use, find out that. So what I have given is an interpolation error here. So I would like to be actually evaluate u minus uh. So I am going to use this interpolation errors in calculating the FE errors. I will state it, I think we can prove it at a in the evening. So the finite element errors that we get, so there again u minus uh less than or equal to h times maximum of 0 less than or equal to y, again in the max norm, I am only giving the result in the max norm. So what did I do here, I did not have a tilde here, the u prime minus uh prime, there is a prime on both u prime. So the errors that you are committing in the derivatives, a derivative estimation is just, it is bound by this. So instead of u tilde I have here u. So that, and second one is the errors that you would commit in the function evaluation is less than or equal to h times, so this is the sup norm, there is no extra, that is that's what we are going to get. In this case, we are going to show. Not the optimal estimate or not the best estimate. So we will see whether h or h square is a question. Is a h right here. In the sup norm is that's what you are going to get. So to get h square, we have to do something. First, we will prove in the proof the h or h square, we will have to see. So it is this. We will have to prove this result to convince ourselves it is not h square. It is not h square means we are not happy about it. We would like to recover h square there. So what is that, we have to do it. So this is in the sup norm. In the sup norm, that's what we would get it. So whether the h or h square, we have to see. So we will have to go and do that. So do we have time to go for that? So I think I would require more time for proving these things. So I would stop here. In the afternoon, we will prove these results. So what is that? We had let's summarize what we have done. So we have started with our simple model problem. We discussed about this different forms of the model problem, then we proposed a weak or a variational form of the problem, and we said that whether we solve the weak or the variational form of the problem or the strong form is one and the same, we have proved the equivalence of the both. Then considering the weak or the variational form of the problem is much better for us, because in that the derivatives are of less order than in the original problem. Then we said that the solution for the weak problem or the variational problem is unique. Then we also showed, we recalled the Lax-Milgram lemma, and then we said that this whole weak form and the variational form obeys the bilinear form in the variational form and the linear form, they both obey all the required conditions like coercivity, continuity, boundedness. So therefore, the Lax-Milgram lemma, which guarantees the uniqueness and existence of the solution for that problem, including the well-postedness, the bound on it, is applicable. Therefore, the problem is solution exists and it is well-posed. So we are happy with it. Then we went into the finite element framework. So we did the entire finite element discretization. What we did? We considered the problem in the infinite dimensional space V, projected it onto the finite dimensional space VH, which means we are going to use finitely many basis functions for approximating this. Which basis function it is, we do not know. Therefore, we are coming an interpolation error. If I move from one interpolation to another interpolation, it will keep on changing, UH will keep on changing. Therefore, we want to distinguish between U and UH. So we had a U, we had a UH, then we had a UH tilde. For a linear function, this will be of one form, for a quadratic function, it will be another, and a cubic function will be another. So UH is being approximated by different kinds of depending upon the interpolation we are going to use, it is going to be very different. Therefore, there is an error as a linear, cubic, quadratic, quintic. So therefore, we just took it this, and what is, so now what we did next is, by doing all this process, how far I am from my exact solution or how good is my approximation. So then we said we need to first find, because I am doing interpolation and also projection, there are two kinds of errors which are coming to the picture there. So if I want to finally find out what is my error in the FE error, I need to take into account my interpolation error and use it, because depends on the kind of the interpolation I use, my errors would be different. So firstly, I estimated my interpolation errors. This is in the function. So what we saw that was previously was in the derivative. So we proved these two results. Now we are going to prove the errors that we would actually be committing by replacing U by UH, which is a projection of U onto the space UH. In proving this, we will be using these interpolation errors. Right. So now, if we prove this, now we get an estimate, and of course, as already pointed out, that this maybe this is not a good thing. We will see whether it is this or whether we have written it wrongly, we will check it up as we prove it. So, what at least one thing it guarantees is whether this is, as I increase the number of the subdivisions, as a dimension of the space increases. So that means I am moving more and more close to my, if I increase more number of points, I am moving more close to considering the entire interval. So h size is decreasing, h is decreasing, the solution should go to 0. So error should go to 0, that is what it is saying. As h becomes 0, close to 0, the errors are decreasing. So this guarantees the convergence process. So this is what basically, that is why it is very, very important to see the whole process is going to as a convergent process. Whatever we are doing, it guarantees the convergence, that is what this tells. So after we prove this FE errors, we will move in the afternoon, we will move to higher dimensions. We will try to do the same thing in two dimensions. Then we will generalize the things for advection deficient equation. This is the goal. Let us see how far we will reach, and Professor Kodira will carry it further for Stokes, Navier-Stokes. Then he will move on to variational multiscale methods and what are the kind of their spaces they are going to use there. So he will define quite a few things. So with that, I think I close now.